So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I want you to give a round of applause for Dr. Paula James, and her talk is Let's Talk, Period.
I'd like to talk to you today about one of my very favorite topics, periods. The monthly bleeding that happens to half of the people on the planet during their reproductive years. Up front, it's important for me to say that despite some of the language I'm going to use in this talk, I understand that not all women menstruate, and not everyone who menstruates identifies as a woman. I know that talking about periods might be uncomfortable for some of you, but there is so much to be gained. We're going to talk about my clinical experiences and frustrations and how they inform the research done by my team. And we're going to talk about how, with our research, we try to improve the lives of patients with bleeding disorders. And we're going to talk about the fact that medicine is sexist. I'm going to start by telling you about one of my patients, Megan, who has given me permission to tell you about her today. Megan has a history of heavy periods that started when she was 12 years old. Her periods would typically last for 8 days out of every month, and for 5 of those days, she had to change her sanitary protection every hour. I want you to think about how tough that would make daily life, how hard it would be to get through classes at school or a day at work if you're having to run to the bathroom every hour. And I also want you to think about the worry and the fear that would come with the idea that you might not make it in time, bleeding through onto your clothes, and the embarrassment and the shame that you would feel. Earlier in my career, when I would teach medical students about bleeding disorders, I would start by asking, who here has heard of hemophilia? And many hands in the room would go up. And then I would ask, who here has heard of von Willebrand disease? And no hands would go up, which is a major problem, because von Willebrand disease is at least 10 times more common than hemophilia. Hemophilia causes bleeding into muscles and joints and has historically been thought of as predominantly affecting males. Von Willebrand disease causes bleeding from the skin and the mucous membranes. And although equally inherited between women and men, it causes significant suffering in women. Please pay attention to that detail from this talk. It's an important message. Women with bleeding disorders suffer, and I'm going to convince you they don't have to. We know from research done right here at Queen's University that has been adopted by the World Federation of Hemophilia and other international organizations that 1 in 1,000 people has an underlying bleeding disorder. However, far fewer are ever diagnosed. In Canada, that means there are 38,000 affected people. But a recent review of our National Bleeding Disorder Registry shows only 8,000. We also know that women who are lucky enough to get a diagnosis of a bleeding disorder wait 16 years or more from the onset of abnormal bleeding symptoms to getting appropriate blood tests done. That's in stark contrast to boys with hemophilia, most of whom are diagnosed by the age of 10. There is never any doubt that a boy with a bleed into his knee has a problem that has to be investigated. But when von Willebrand disease causes heavy periods and bleeding after childbirth, and a certain amount of bleeding at those times is normal, and we live in a society that has historically ignored women's health, a clear understanding of when that bleeding becomes too much has been lacking. I am willing to bet that most of the 30,000 Canadians who has a bleeding disorder but don't know it are women. Sorting out normal from abnormal bleeding is tough because we all bleed if you cut us, and we all bruise when we bump into things. Every day that I'm in clinic, I see people who've been referred with heavy periods, and my job is to figure out who has an underlying bleeding disorder, knowing that 15 to 30% of them do. The stories I hear are so similar. My periods last for 10 days out of every month, but so did my mother's, and so I thought that was normal. Remember, we're talking about inherited bleeding disorders, and so bleeding symptoms can be passed on within a family and overlooked. Unfortunately, even more common is my periods last for 10 days out of every month, and I went to see my doctor about it, but he said that was normal. Spoiler alert, it's not. People with periods like that are at risk of becoming iron deficient and anemic, suffering from symptoms like fatigue and poor concentration, poor work and school performance, hair loss, brittle nails. Patients who are iron deficient tell me that it feels like they're trying to think through cobwebs, or that they're walking around with cinder blocks on their feet. The fact is, those symptoms are entirely preventable with proper treatment. The fact that women commonly and regularly suffer them, honestly, it makes me so angry. Of course, as I mentioned, medicine is sexist. And as additional proof of that, I submit to you ferritin normal ranges. Ferritin is a widely available blood test, and it's the best measure we've got of body iron stores. In adult women, the normal range of ferritin is said to go from 4 to 205 micrograms per liter. The problem is, most experts agree that someone with a ferritin of less than 30 is iron deficient, not just someone with a ferritin of less than 4. So that means a woman with a ferritin of 5, that lab value doesn't get flagged as abnormal, leaving her at risk of being ignored by her healthcare practitioner, not given iron supplementation, and at risk of suffering all those symptoms we talked about. I think if we made male healthcare leaders have to walk around with a ferritin of 5 for a few days, iron deficiency would become a public health emergency. And things like flawed ferritin normal ranges that were clearly derived from a population of women who were iron deficient would be fixed overnight. I mentioned that telling the difference between normal and abnormal bleeding is tough. And so in the early 2000s, my amazing research team started working on bleeding assessment tools, or BATS. BATS are bleeding questionnaires that guide an expert healthcare practitioner to ask a series of questions about bleeding. For example, do you have a problem with nosebleeds? And if the answer is yes, how often? How do you get them to stop? Did you ever have to see a doctor because of nosebleeds? And based on the results, a bleeding score can be calculated. From our study of thousands of individuals with and without bleeding disorders, we've been able to figure out when the bleeding score becomes positive or abnormal, meaning there's too much bleeding and that person might have a bleeding disorder. We validated the bleeding score prospectively and showed that it's a very effective screening tool for bleeding disorders here in Kingston in 50 family practices. And then one of my master's students took the next step, and she converted the expert-administered tool into something that can be self-administered by anyone, anywhere who's worried about their bleeding, from their phone or their computer, and the self-BAT was born. We showed that the self-BAT works just as well as the expert-administered version, and then we made it widely and freely available. We did that through a website that we launched in 2016 that we called, of course, Let's Talk Period. Our goal with the website was to break through the stigma against open and honest conversations about periods and to provide accessible and accurate information. On the homepage, we highlight the red flags of heavy periods. These include periods that last for longer than 7 days per month, periods that require a change of sanitary protection more than every hour, periods that lead to iron deficiency, and periods that regularly cause soaking through, bleeding onto your clothes and onto the sheets at night. Those are all abnormal features. I remember being so nervous the night before we launched the website. I was new to social media and afraid of getting online hate, or maybe even worse, that no one would use the site. Happily, the response to Let's Talk Period has been amazing. And a surprise, even to someone like me who loves to talk about periods. To date, 300,000 people have visited the site from 190 countries. 32,000 people have taken the self-bat. Our aligned Facebook page has had a reach of 1.5 million, meaning 1.5 million people have seen our content. And we've heard stories from all over the world about people who visited the site and taken the self-bat and gotten a bleeding disorder diagnosis. I'd like to tell you one of those stories now. So we go back to Megan, who I first met when she was 31 years old. At that point, she'd had heavy periods for 20 years. She also had difficulty with gum bleeding, nosebleeds, and easy bruising. No one in her family had ever been diagnosed with a bleeding disorder, but her mom and her aunt had both had hysterectomies at early ages because of heavy periods. Following the birth of her first child, Megan had serious bleeding in the delivery room and lost so much blood that her husband, who is a paramedic trained to estimate blood loss, didn't tell her how scared he'd been for many years. He'd been scared she was going to bleed to death right in front of him. And what was even scarier was no one knew why it was happening. Thankfully, Megan knows a member of my team who advised her to take a look at our website and to take the self-bat. She did, and her bleeding score was positive, so she took the printout provided by the site to her family doc, who promptly referred her to hematology. When I first saw her in clinic, we measured her von Willebrand factor levels and found them to be low. So we diagnosed her with type 1 von Willebrand disease, the most common inherited bleeding disorder. We managed her periods and other bleeding with medications like tranexamic acid and hormones, and we gave her iron supplementation to correct her iron deficiency. Since we first met, Megan has required a number of surgeries and procedures unrelated to her bleeding disorder. And with the help of my amazing clinical team, we've been able to prevent excessive bleeding every time. Without our input, she would have been at risk of serious, potentially life-threatening bleeding. It's fair to say that Megan's quality of life has improved immensely, and that she no longer wonders what's wrong with her or worries that she's going to bleed. In fact, when I teach medical students now, I take Megan with me, and she tells them her story. And I'm not exaggerating when I say it's the most effective teaching I have ever done. No one in that room will ever forget how to recognize, diagnose, and manage von Willebrand disease. Every one of those students will promptly and proudly raise their hand if they're asked in the future who here has heard of von Willebrand disease. Here's an additional story to tell you that I know this is possible, that I know we can make conversations about periods and bleeding disorders comfortable. I'm the only girl in my house. My husband and I have two sons. And I talk about periods and bleeding disorders at the dinner table a fair bit. Many years ago, on Take Your Kid to Work Day, when my oldest was 14, he came with me to one of my teaching sessions. And when I asked the question, who here has heard of von Willebrand disease? His was the only hand to go up at the back of the room behind all of the other students, and I was so very proud. I want all of you who are listening today to remember Megan's story and remember that the red flags that she had a bleeding disorder were there for years. Pay attention if you or anyone in your life has any of the features of heavy periods that we've talked about. Feel free to visit letstalkperiod.ca and take the self-bat and talk with your doctor. There are physicians out there who understand periods and who will listen to women. We have the tools and the knowledge to diagnose bleeding disorders, and we're fortunate to have safe and effective treatments with innovative new therapies on the horizon. We can do better for the next generation and prevent a great deal of suffering. I remain committed to improving the lives of people with bleeding disorders by continuing to talk about periods. Thank you for the opportunity to share this with you today.